The Fabulous 413 podcast is funded by Northeast Solar, offering solar options, energy security, and solutions for the local community. Learn more at northeast-solar.com.
What were your favorites when you were watching them? Well, Bugs Bunny, I think, is everybody's favorite.
Yeah, he's my absolute favorite. But, you know, I also like Marvin Martian, Gossamer, the big orange monster with the sneakers. That's one of my absolute favorites. But then the music, too. I mean, the music also stars in the cartoons. And that's what I think the genius of Carl Stalling and Milt Franklin did, is that they selected from the classical, but they also let the music be part of the whole thing. The music's the star as well. And so this is what's going to be exciting to see for me with the Springfield Symphony and the cartoons, and you conducting. It's going to be wonderful to
watch
this.
I'm just there to assist Bugs.
What's up, Doc? The Springfield Symphony Orchestra will host two shows of Bugs Bunny at the Symphony, Saturday, May 4th, 2:30 and 7:30 at Springfield Symphony Hall.
16 Looney Tunes animated shorts will be shown on the big screen above the orchestra as their iconic classically infused original scores are played by the Springfield Symphony Orchestra.
The performances are conducted by Emmy Award-winning conductor George Daugherty, who joins us now, as does the NEPM Classical Anchor, heard weekdays from 9 to 1 on 91.9 and 89.3 in Hampshire County, 91.7 in Franklin County, 89.5 in the Southern Berkshires, 98.9 in the Northern Berkshires. Our favorite person, I dare say, at NEPM, and huge Looney Tunes fan.
Oh, yeah.
John Nowacki.
In addition to joining us here in studio, John will also be joining the maestro for a talk about the concert after the second performance at Symphony Hall. We are also joined by Springfield Symphony Orchestra President Paul Lambert. Thank you so much for joining us.
What a good day, huh?
Coincidentally, we are told that today is National Bugs Bunny Day.
Exactly.
Oh my
right.
Gosh.
So it's just perfect timing.
I know John thinks that every day should be National
Absolutely.
Bugs Bunny Day.
I mean,
I'm almost tempted to start with John Nowacki, but we're definitely going to get there. But we have the Emmy Award-winning maestro with us. Tell us, first of all, what gave you the idea in 1990 to say maybe a large swath of U.S. Americans got their first taste of classical music from Looney Tunes? I know I did. We should turn this into a show. What was that inspiration, George?
It was actually 1989. It was actually Bugs Bunny's 50th birthday in 1989. And I was in the middle of a very, very serious, busy, ultra, uber, maestro European and American conducting career at that time. I was conducting at the Munich Staatsoper, at La Scala in Milan, at Opera House, American Ballet Theater in New York. So I wasn't thinking very much about cartoons. However, I had grown up on these cartoons and loved them as a kid. And the music grabbed me before the animation did. It was incredible. So anyway, I was doing a very highfalutin animation project with dancers and animation and everything. They brought out this new fangled thing called a Betamax machine with videos of these cartoons. Now, at this point, I was, you know, in my early 30s. I hadn't seen these cartoons for 20 years. So I saw What's Opera Doc, The Rabbit of Seville, Long-Haired Hare. And once again, I was just completely infused, as you said, or actually, we'd had a few glasses of wine, so I was infused, as you said. And I realized how brilliant this music was. So I had this wacky idea, let's do a concert. But my idea was only to play the music. Immediately, when I started investigating that, it became really clear that the music only is brilliant if you see it in tandem with the animation. So, okay, let's figure out how to do a concert with the animation. I went to Warner Brothers. I pitched this whole thing. And amazingly, they said, because it was Bugs Bunny's 50th birthday, they said, okay, let's do this. We scheduled it in San Diego with the San Diego Symphony. They ran a big Sunday ad, and the first thing that happened to everyone's absolute amazement is that by Monday, it was totally sold out. 3,000 tickets sold out virtually in 12 hours, 15 hours. We only had four cartoons with orchestra. The audience went bananas. Everyone loved it. Warner Brothers loved it. Everybody loved it. We went back to Los Angeles and waited and waited and waited for the studio to decide what to do next, and waited and waited. And then in August of 1990, at this point, Warner Brothers and called and said, could you open on Broadway in 2 weeks? So I foolishly said, yes, of course, we can open on Broadway in 2 weeks. And we did. We prepared two more cartoons very quickly. And so we had six. We opened on Broadway. It was sold out, extended. And that's how it all started.
That is the maestro, George Darty, who will be under the baton with the Springfield Symphony Orchestra this weekend for two performances, Bugs Bunny at the Symphony, Saturday, May 4th, 2:30 and 7:30. John Nowacki,
yes.
NEPM classical host. I know the question is often, what came first, the chicken or the egg? But what came first, the music or the bunny?
Oh, boy, that's a tough question. I think they both kind of grew together, quite frankly.
Were you like a big Bugs Bunny fan and then it tipped you off into the world of classical? Or were
yes.
you a classical music fan and loved Bugs Bunny?
You have to remember, I was a kid. I grew up watching these in my pajamas on a Saturday morning, getting acquainted with the music, but it was through the antics of Bugs Bunny and company. And so for me, that was how it all started. And I've heard that over and over and over again throughout the years of broadcasting. You know, this is how I learned about classical music was Bugs Bunny.
The music, which came first, the music or the animation, it differed from cartoon to cartoon.
Yeah.
Because, for example, The Rabbit of Seville is a pretty faithful playing of the Barber of Seville overture, but with a lot of stuff added into it.
How about a nice close shave, teacher whispers to behave, lots of leather, lots of soap, please hold still, don't be a dope, now we're ready for the...
But still, it is pretty faithful from beginning to end. And so in this particular case, the track was recorded first, and then the animators animated to the music. In contrast, what's Opera Doc?
Be very quiet. I'm hunting rabbits.
Now, what's Opera Doc is a miraculous thing because it's just not a bit of Wagner here and there. Carl Stalling and Milt Franklin, of course, Carl Stalling and Milt Franklin being the two composers who did these miraculous scores, and in the case of What's Opera Doc, it was
rabbit,
Milt Franklin. In the case of The Rabbit of Seville, it was Carl Stalling.
Build a rabbit, build a rabbit, build a rabbit.
In What's Opera Doc, they took the entire major themes of all four Ring Cycle operas. And they decided, well, no, that's not enough. So we're going to add The Flying Dutchman. We're going to add Lohengrin. We're going to add Rienzi. And we're going to add Tannhäuser. So they took the major themes from eight Wagner operas, which we perform in 6 minutes and 35 seconds.
Yeah. As opera was intended.
The pastiche of that score is nothing short of brilliant, the way it's all woven together.
What I love about that particular cartoon is at the very end, after all of that, Bugs's comment is, well, what'd you expect in an opera? A happy ending?
A happy ending.
Which is like, oh my gosh, it's just brilliant. What a great way to end that.
Well, what did you expect in an opera? A happy ending?
We're speaking with Maestro George Darty, who on Saturday, May 4th, will have two shows of Bugs Bunny at the Symphony, 2:30 and 7:30. Our very own NEPM classical host John Nowacki will be there in conversation after the 7:30 performance.
And we will all be enflused by then.
Yes. It's a great night to be enflused.
You mentioned Carl Stalling and Milt Franklin, both composers who worked in early animation, both adapting already existing scores for the animation that was happening, and then writing things too. Like Carl Stalling is responsible for the Looney Tunes theme, with which everyone is familiar. And I was actually listening to that more carefully.
And the Merry Melodies theme.
And the Merry Melodies theme, yeah. He had a connection with Disney in his early projects too. Like
who?
Yeah.
Who framed Roger Rabbit? It's both.
Before the
no!
But can you talk about their compositions as part of this program too? Because their work is also integral to this.
People who don't really know the genre sometimes think they were just repackaging, you know, classical tunes all the time, which is not the case. They're quite amazing musicians in their own right. Carl Stalling was born in Lexington, Minnesota. By the time he was 10 years old, he was playing the piano in the little silent movie house in his hometown of Lexington. This was back in silent movies when he was already composing film scores before films even had scores. Milt Franklin did the same thing on the West Coast. Carl met this bedraggled animation director who was carrying around a portfolio full of mouse drawings. And this guy happened to be Walt Disney. So Carl followed him to Los Angeles. Walt Disney first did the Silly Symphonies, and Carl scored those. And then there was this huge revolution where movies suddenly had sound, and Warner Brothers was the place. Disney was a tiny little studio back then. Carl went over to Warner Brothers, and the appeal for Warner Brothers for Carl Stalling is that for the cartoons, Warner Brothers used the full 100-member Warner Brothers Orchestra for the cartoons. At Disney, he was working with a 15 or 16-piece studio orchestra. Now, eventually, of course, Disney did the huge things with Sleeping Beauty and Snow White and Cinderella and all the big, epic, long animation, fantastic feature films. But back then, they were just using a tiny little orchestra. And so Carl said, I want to get my hands on it, on the Warner Brothers Orchestra. What's Opera Doc is scored totally in the Wagnerian style and size. Whereas The Rabbit of Seville, a much leaner Rossini kind of sound.
Springfield Symphony Orchestra president Paul Lambert, are audiences still clamoring for Bugs Bunny like they were in the 80s when I was a kid and even earlier when some of the other people here were kids?
Absolutely. I mean, ticket sales are going very well.
Yeah.
And more so, what's really exciting to us, of course, is the fact that this is an opportunity to bring in very new audiences. When I saw this go across my screen the first time, I got so excited at the prospect of bringing in families and bringing in children. And, you know, we just had a concert at Symphony Hall recently where we had over 2,000 fourth graders came in. We love getting young folks in, folks who have maybe not been to a symphony concert before, to hear the beautiful music and to experience the Springfield Symphony Orchestra up close and personal, and to know it's for them, to know they're welcome, to know they're celebrated. We want them all to come, not just to see Bugs, but also for many years to come to make this part of their life.
With most symphony orchestras, 70% of the people that come to this concert have never been to a symphony orchestra live concert in their lives.
I want people always to know that they're not coming to a museum piece. They're coming to a live art form, something that's joyous and fun. And as you know, there's something very special about being in the room where the music happens, as opposed to watching it on a television at home. So we hope people can embrace that and come take advantage of it.
The way the orchestra plays, no one will ever be able to listen and look at an animated short in the same way after they see this. So the orchestra is the star.
NEPM's John Nowacki, we have had an inordinate amount of conversations about Looney Tunes and Bugs Bunny, just informally here at the office. What is it about Looney Tunes and Mel Blanc and all these people that still resonates with you all these years later after watching them as a kid?
Well, you know, I've always said that Bugs Bunny is my personal hero, and my favorite quotes are always from him. Things like, it's the suspense that kills me. That's one of my favorite, absolute favorite quotes. You know, wisecracking, he's going about his own business, and every time he's going about his own business, somebody's out to get him. And that's the impetus for the entire film. Oh, isn't that just like life? You know, we're going along fine, and then something happens. And how do we react? Wisecracking, that's my favorite. But it's this wonderful combination, I think, about this concert coming up of the films. You're seeing these films again, and they were restored. Is that right, George? That these have
been
restored.
We went back to the original negatives and
digitally gussied them up. And for me, it's going to be an experience because I love orchestra. I love being able to see them and hear them. But now I'm going to be distracted by the cartoons, too.
So we do it in a way that you can take it all in at one time. You'll be surprised. Don't sit too close. That's the thing about it.
Right.
It's going to be a great two shows this coming Saturday. Springfield Symphony Orchestra hosting Maestro George Doherty and Bugs Bunny at the Symphony. 2:30 in the afternoon, and then 7:30 with special guest, NEPM's own John Nowacki, Springfield Symphony Orchestra President Paul Lambert, Maestro George Doherty. Thank you all so much.
My pleasure.
Ever be here, that's all, folks.
Is that water up for grabs?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
You know what? Let's get you a new one, because
I don't know
how long this was here.
Oh, got it. Okay,
I don't know if somebody opened it or not. But
oh, that's fine. Yeah. Oh, thank you.
It's like my shuffleboard technique.
Yeah, spilling it all over, just like Elizabeth Warren.
Yeah.
She was very excited and just knocked it all over the table.
She did warn us. She flailed a lot.
Well, she's aware.
Yeah,
you
right.
Know.
Amythyst Kiah was born in Chattanooga, Tennessee. She attended a creative arts high school and taught herself to play guitar. Kiah is a graduate of East Tennessee State University, where she completed the Bluegrass, Old Time, and Country Music Studies program, where she segued into playing banjo.
Her Rounder Records debut, Wary and Strange, earned rave reviews from Rolling Stone, The New York Times, and NPR, calling the album a breakthrough for an artist on the rise. She then followed that with the Covers EP, featuring her take on a number of songs important to her growth, including tracks by Tori Amos, Joy Division, and more. Amythyst Kiah is part of a supergroup, Songs for Our Native Daughters, alongside Allison Russell, Layla McCalla, and certified MacArthur genius, Rhiannon Giddens. She's just released a cover of the classic, In the Pines.
She was also highlighted in a New York Times Magazine feature and documentary, The Next Generation of Black Folk Singers. She's the subject of an episode of PBS's The Expressway with Dulé Hill, which will air tonight, April 30th at 9 p.m.
Right here on NEPM TV!
I know, so shocking. The show focuses on storytelling through lived experiences and how arts can foster empathy, understanding, and positive change within society. And in addition to seeing her on our very own NEPM TV this evening, you can catch her at the Parlor Room in Northampton tonight.
Yeah, maybe you have to DVR the NEPM show, go to the show at the Parlor Room, and then come home and watch it to get your like double shot of Amythyst Kiah.
I'd be down for that.
That would be totally great. Can we hear a song to start?
Sure, would love to. Well, I feel like I should probably start with In the Pines, so we'll do that.
Fantastic.
My girl, where will you go?
Come on.
thank you.
It's so good.
That's Amythyst Kiah. We have to tell everybody who's just tuning in. Playing tonight at the Parlor Room in Northampton, but also on NEPM TV tonight at 9 o'clock on the Expressway with Dulé Hill.
Accidental twofer. Covers are fascinating.
Oh, thank you.
Not just like your covers EP that came out, where your reinterpretation of Sugar is one of my favorite covers that's happened in the past couple of years, but like this one, when your people sent it to us, I was just struck by how humanizing you made this song, how much more grief there was in your version of the song than there has been in previous versions that I've heard. And I was curious about how you go about your covers bringing that humanity into these songs that you love.
For me, it really starts from years in my room listening to music uninterrupted and just trying different things without really having any pretense or anybody in my ear telling me not to do it. For me, like, alternative music was kind of gateway for me to really find where I am. It really helped me, inspired me to really kind of dig into like the deeper emotions. And I think what had me a little disillusioned, there was a lot of things going on at the time because I was growing up in like a conservative white Christian suburbia. And we were like one of the only black families in the neighborhood and in the area. And also, you know, my dad was, both of my parents are very much about, you know, as far as religion goes, finding your own path. Because there's so many different religions and cultures and that have been happening for thousands of years. So like, they wanted me to have the opportunity to like explore and figure out what resonates with me. But that also gave me a lot of grief because I was kind of becoming disillusioned with this sort of shiny, happy, like, oh yeah, we live in the suburbs and we've got Blockbuster, and I'm telling my age here. we got Blockbuster and we've got Panera Bread, we've got Target, we've got the mall, you know? And then starting to realize that like all of the things that went into creating that vision was in a lot of ways just not reflective of a lot of people's lives and a lot of people's emotional worlds. And, you know, at 15, I saw the movie The Matrix, and that completely kind of blew my mind. And I'm like, oh, so this might be why I feel so odd and out of place in this space, you know? So music was the way to like explore other ideas. And I got really into like Eastern philosophy, elements of Stoicism, and, you know, and like the Buddha and Taoism and all of that stuff. So I really kind of had the opportunity to sort of explore all these different ideas. And my, you know, my father has always encouraged being as free thinking as humanly possible. When it comes to my covers, it's important for me that if I'm going to cover a song, for one, it has to really hit me on an emotional level. And then the other thing is, depending on how many times it's been recorded, I have to make sure that whatever I do, I'm adding new information to the song and not just doing the exact same thing.
That is Amythyst Kiah, who's performing tonight at the Parlor Room in Northampton and will also be featured on the PBS show The Expressway with Dulé Hill, which will air tonight on NEPM TV. You have described yourself to Billboard magazine as a, quote, funny-talking, sci-fi-loving queer black. I don't know anyone else who is the co-host of my show who fits that exact description. So I kind of just want to set you off onto a nerd out tangent.
Right, yeah.
Go for it, Khalees. Where do you want to begin?
Well, I did want to ask what your current favorite anime is. We saw a list of the things that are your favorites in general. It's a good list. But currently, even though you're on tour, I'm assuming that you have some downtime. What are you currently watching? What's currently your favorite?
Well, I haven't watched any new anime as of late. The last thing that I did watch was I watched the original Ghost in the Shell for the first time, and I can't believe I took that this long to see it. Because I was like, oh, I see where The Matrix came from. Like, I just had no idea how much it had influenced that movie, and I was just like, okay, this is great. So that's the last thing I saw that was anime, but right now I finished up a show called Good Omens. And I just recently finally got into like reading Neil Gaiman and some of his comics. I read Death fairly recently. But then me and my fiance started watching Good Omens, and we watched both of the seasons. That's been the latest thing. We also started watching Fallout. So yeah.
If anyone needs a glimpse of what like
13, 14-year-old Khalees was like, Death, it remains one of my favorite comic books.
I did Death for this past Halloween, which was fun.
Every time I
pulled out the black lip. I borrowed my fiance's black lipstick, and I'm like, this is kind of cool.
Every time I don't want to think about a costume, I go to a party as Death.
Yeah.
Not to bring it full circle, but like, there's the Tori Amos connection, because Delirium's based on Tori Amos. We got way into it. That didn't take very long.
I prompted you to. I wanted this to happen. Yeah. This is the magic between Khalees and Amythyst Kiah playing tonight at the Parlor Room.
In similar geek out fashion, I read that for your electrics, you like having medium strings on the low end and light strings on the high end. And how do you accomplish that without totally messing up your truss rod?
For listeners, this is guitar nerding out now. We've transitioned from anime nerding out to guitar nerding out.
I like doing that, but I definitely have ruined at least two guitars doing that.
Oh, interesting. Yeah, well, I think, here's the thing. While I love guitars, sometimes I don't always know. Does this have a truss rod in it? Yeah, it does. You know, I usually just kind of just, I just get it adjusted. Anytime I've had a guitar and then like I put those, well, usually they're called bluegrass strings. At least D'Addario, they sell them and they call them the bluegrass strings. But yeah, I just sort of had it, I just like get the intonation changed and they adjust the truss rod. Because I love the idea of being able to like do my own guitar tech work, but then also it's like, am I going to write a song or am I going to learn how my guitar works?
You know? Martin made you a custom guitar. Don't want to break it.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
Especially because it's so pretty.
It is. Yeah. And it sounds so fantastic.
And they put the strings that I wanted on it and they adjust it to where it's going to be fine. So yeah.
When I saw you at Big Ears, you mentioned that there is a new album headed our way possibly this year. Do you want to talk about it?
Yeah. So this album is called Still and Bright with the plus sign in the middle. This really opens like a new chapter in my, I guess, in my life, just in my personal life and also as a songwriter. I had to figure out how am I going to write songs. I had to go back to the drawing board because before, when I wrote songs, it was the catalyst for the song would be emotional turmoil. And I've worked really hard in therapy to not be in emotional turmoil for like 8 years. I've been on this 8-year mental health healing journey. And I was like, I have to figure out how am I going to write songs now? Because I don't want to obviously go back to how I was feeling before. And I jumped on YouTube and just started like following like songwriting YouTube channels. One of the channels recommended this book, How to Write One Song by Jeff Tweedy.
I just asked my wife to get that out of the library for me for my plane ride today, right before you came here.
Yeah, and I read it, and what really, what was so helpful for me is that he just totally demystifies songwriting. He's like, if you want to have a sustained career, like writing songs, you have to write every day. Even if you write it and you're like, wow, this actually really sucks, that's fine. You just keep writing. You just write every day. And so it's a thing where you can't just wait on inspiration to hit you. It's almost like if you're trying to have like a workout routine or something like that. If you want to be consistent, you can't just like, oh, I'll just go when I feel like it, because you're never really going to see the results you want. But if you want to be a songwriter that has lots of good songs, you have to write lots of bad ones also. And when I started thinking of it like a Tetris puzzle, as opposed to I have to pour my soul and my trauma into everything, like it makes it more fun to not only write the song, because it doesn't feel like I'm like extrapolating my pain out of myself all the time. It's like, oh, I'm really into, like, for instance, I'm really interested in this show called Old Gods of Appalachia. It's super awesome.
It's fantastic.
And I decided I want to write my own cosmic horror song. So there's a cosmic horror song that's going to be on the record called Gods Under the Mountain. So it's like, oh, I can have fun doing this and have fun talking about it. Because when I did Wary and Strange, when I did the campaign, I didn't really think about the fact that talking about my personal experiences over and over and over again, like, I didn't realize how much of an emotional toll it was going to take on me. So while I was having the moment in my life that I always wanted, which was a label debut and people, you know, recognizing and, you know, loving what I do and being able to, you know, have that experience. But then underneath there was this, like, this constant kind of reliving of, like, the past going on in my head as I'm talking. And I had no way of knowing that that was going to be what happened, how my brain was going to respond, you know. It has been such an amazing experience, and I've learned so much. And I kind of feel like I know what I'm doing now, if that makes sense. The idea is supposed to come out in the fall. But, yeah, I'm super stoked on it and super excited to share the fun side of myself, which I don't feel like I've been able to really show, which I'm kind of my own worst enemy in that case. So
you have to get going. I could talk to you all afternoon and this would be real easy and awesome, but you need to get ready for your show. So let's hear one more song before we let you go to soundcheck at the Parlor Room in Northampton, where you can see Amythyst Kiah tonight.
Sure, would love to. Thanks so much again for having me. This has been
our
such
pleasure.
A fun conversation.
When your people reach out to us, that was the fastest reply I think I've ever sent to an email.
Seconded.
Well, thank you so much. Really appreciate that. Well, I think I'll play another song that will be on the new record, and it's a song that I wrote to pay homage to growing up in East Tennessee, and just because you live in East Tennessee or the South, it doesn't mean that you have to stick with what everybody else is doing or what everybody else believes in. My idea with this song was to, you know, for the first time really explicitly talk about my beliefs. I believe in seeking and learning about other people's other religions and other ways of living, and then kind of decide for yourself, hey, this actually works for me. It resonates with me. So anyway, this song sort of talks about that. So this one's called Empire of Love.
Oh, hypocrisy or some idol ideology. We're all made from stars from above. I pledge allegiance to my soul. I find on where she needs to go. I'm a pilgrim for the empire of love.
That is Amythyst Kiah, who's playing the Parlor Room in Northampton tonight. Go see that show if you can. And DVR NEPM television tonight at 9 o'clock. If people still use DVR, I don't even know anymore. You can check her out on the Expressway with Dulé Hill tonight on NEPM TV. This has been amazing. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you. It's been a pleasure.
You can stream it if you miss it.
Oh, yeah, right. There's
you
the
get
internets.
PBS Passport.
Yes, on yeah, the PBS Passport app.
There we go. Shameless plug.
Hampshire Pride is this Saturday, May the 4th, and here to tell us all about it are two of the organizers, Alden Peotter, a University of Massachusetts Eisenberg School alumni and co-owner of the Majestic Saloon, and Clay Pearson, another UMass Eisenberg alum and senior product development specialist.
Is management why this parade has been so well organized, even on short order after last year? I think you did it in a month.
Last year, we had 9 weeks, and only a month of that was able to fundraise.
Yeah.
So that made it even more difficult.
Yeah.
But it takes a village to get this parade and the whole organization going together. So especially, you know, starting from scratch as we did last March 1st.
Oh, yeah.
Yes. And we had you on to talk about that then. And
oh, yeah.
This is a storied event that's had a rich and varied history in Northampton over the years.
For
but
sure.
This is the second year under your auspices, right?
Yes.
We're also joined by Alden Peotter, whose last name may be familiar to folks who love public media. Your dad gave me my first break in public media. But you're the co-owner of the Majestic Saloon, which is an iconic now, I think. Is it too soon to call it iconic? Maybe
not. I don't
think
so.
I'll call it iconic.
Yeah, there we go. Gay club in Northampton. So were you involved in Pride last year, or is this your first time involved with Pride?
I was not. I work at Majestic with Kayla Abney, the other co-owner, and she was much more involved last year. Mm-hmm. I've kind of stepped in. She still worked with me on the parade, but I was definitely tied to her a lot last year, mm-hmm. so I was very interested in being in it this year.
And it used to be Northampton Pride or NoHo Pride, and now
Correct.
It's Hampshire Pride. Talk about the mission that your organization brings to this event.
Hampshire Pride was born out of kind of the vacuum of Pride that happened during the COVID pandemic, and we wanted to make sure that something happened. And I was really upset when 2022 came around and nothing had gone to play, and I said, I'll get involved, and eventually found out that I had to start up a new organization because the old one just wasn't up and running anymore.
Yeah. You do, however, keep it on the traditional first weekend of May, which is how the Northampton Pride parades have historically been.
Historically, the first weekend of May, and everyone's going to go, but June is Pride Month.
Yeah.
What are you doing?
You're way out in front of it.
Well, we got to be extra. We're extra special for sure. I mean, if you haven't met us, we're a force to be reckoned with for sure.
But, Clay is wearing an amazing suit. Well, a sport coat.
It's a suit,
Hampshire Pride T-shirt, but also incredible purple high heels.
Just a subtle 7 inches. We definitely had to walk up a flight of stairs or two to get in here. So that was my workout for
the
day.
You can take the elevator down. It's okay.
Back to the first weekend of May. Why the first weekend of May?
Well, it's best to be the first.
Yeah.
I mean, Pride is such a special event, and we're lucky enough to live in an area where there's a lot of celebrations all throughout the month of June. By being early in May, we hit the ground running. We get people excited for Pride Month to come, and we're not going to cross with any other event that's going on, yeah. And that's really important to us.
Isn't there a historical tie to Stonewall and the first weekend of May with the...
There's a lot of lore out there, and there's a lot of people that suggest the dates don't line up, and so I'm going to try to shy away from that and say, also, we like to do it for the Five College Network to make sure that they are all able to be present, because if you go into June,
right.
All the students take their exams and they peace out.
Right.
So having all the youth and the vibrancy is what makes Hampshire Pride great, too.
One of the neat things I think about this separation is that you've been able to do a lot more with the Pride celebration, even in your 1 year of tenure. But want to talk about some of the new things that you've brought and been able to do in this Pride.
What I'm mainly working on is the parade. So having that be even bigger and better, that's really important to us. But I think another big thing about this year's Pride is we have a 5-hour drag stage.
Yes, as well as a 5-hour main stage.
Yes.
Two stages,
doubling up. But by having this drag stage, last year, a large portion of the proceeds made were done primarily by drag queens, and this is kind of an homage to that and giving them a much longer spotlight.
We're speaking with Alden Peotter and Clay Pearson, who are two of the organizers of Hampshire Pride, which is happening this Saturday, May the 4th. So we've got this very long drag review. Talk about the parade itself. When does it start? Where's a great places to watch this parade?
All along Route 9, starting at Sheldon Field, all the way into the center of downtown. We're going to start at Sheldon Field, as I mentioned, at 11. And the parade typically is about an hour and a half, 2 hours. We disperse over at the end of Crafts Ave. But really, there's a large area to view the entire parade, and it goes on for a while. We are looking at about 1,800 marchers.
Wow.
That's awesome.
That's a lot of marchers. I know my Kung Fu school is marching.
Oh, yeah. It's going to be really big this year, and I'm super excited for it.
Yeah, and one other thing to note is if you are watching the parade, at the end of the parade, after the final float, which will be the Majestic Saloons float, you can join in the march yourself. So at that point, we are asking the community to march into town. And that's what I love about bringing the parade in this direction than maybe the traditional way that it might have been done since 2009.
Yeah.
Because that was the last time that it used to go this way.
Right. You'd march from Thorns, essentially, to the fairgrounds.
And
now it's
and now
reversed.
We're bringing it back home, bringing it back into town, and bringing all that business into town to support the local community. And there's going to be 100 vendors there. So
nice.
I think last year we had maybe 60. So once again,
doubling
up.
It.
Yeah,
that was kind of the theme for
us. It felt full last year too, so it's going to feel even fuller this year.
You've also got Drag Story Hour. Talk about incorporating multiple generations into this year's Pride.
Even last year, we had quite a few school groups, and another aspect of getting multi-generation in there is we need to protect them. And there's a group that I hold dear, and it's called the Parasol Patrol, and they're there to shield children from hate. And so if there are any protesters, we have these Rainbow Parasol Patrol people that will use their parasols to make sure that they block the hate from the children. So they're being protected in the parade itself. And then after that, we're going to have a drag story hour. Also, during the proclamation and the story hour, we're going to have an ASL interpreter. So we're really trying to focus on the accessibility to this space as well.
We're speaking with Clay Pearson and Alden Peotter, who are the organizers, a couple of the organizers of Hampshire Pride happening Saturday, May the 4th. I've been to Pride a bazillion times, and I've maybe seen a number of protesters I can count on my hands, which I think goes to tell you a lot about the area in which we live. Are you anticipating that there may be some protesters?
We're not anticipating, but it's always best to be prepared.
Right. Yeah.
You know, I was a Boy Scout once upon a time, so be prepared for sure. We've obviously got another patrol. It's called the Dyke Patrol, and they are going to be providing a non-confrontational de-escalation type security for our parade and vendor festival area. Multiple layers of making sure everything's safe and secure.
Dyke Patrol is taking all members of the community who want to come and help and make sure that this event is protected and safe for all involved. So, like, don't feel like you have to be queer
Correct.
To be a part of it. Anyone can join the Dyke Patrol and
Correct.
Help out.
The festivities and the parade are, by and large, very family friendly. But if you are a grown-up and you like consuming alcoholic beverages, there's also a bar crawl that I'm assuming Majestic Saloon, which you're a co-owner of, Alden Peotter, is going to be part of. Talk about the bar crawl that's in conjunction with Hampshire Pride.
Yeah, bar crawl. I believe, what's the count on it now? How many bars? Ten bars. You get a wristband for every bar you go to. Oh. So if you get them all, I believe you win.
You can get a contest for a t-shirt. So we'll hand out a handful of t-shirts.
Nice.
But last year, I mean, we did the same thing, and it was just bars were packed all day. You know, we didn't see life like that in Northampton way before COVID even. I was like, since I was a kid, I haven't seen Northampton like that. So it was super energizing to see all the people out and about all day long, long after the festivities.
There's also an event happening the next day that is dovetails nicely with Hampshire Pride, even though the official festivities are on Saturday and the parade is on Saturday at 11. Elliot Page, the iconic actor, the author of the book Page Boy, is going to be in conversation with Dallas Dukar, who is the CEO of Trans Health. And I believe the Lieutenant Governor is going to be part of
Ken Driscoll's coming.
This conversation as well on Sunday at the Academy of Music. I'll say on our show's behalf that we tried desperately to get Elliot Page on the show.
You have no idea
Dallas.
How hard we tried.
Many emails and many texts, and it didn't work out, but I
love letters.
Want
like,
to tell people if they want to go hear Elliot Page.
Promises of firstborn.
In conversation with a fireside chat with Dallas Dukar. That's happening also on Pride Weekend on Sunday at the Academy of Music. This is an event that you may, Alden, having grown up in the area, been more familiar with. I knew you, Clay, came from Florida to Massachusetts, right?
The first Pride I went to was the last one that went this direction in 2009.
Wow.
No.
So I've been to it for a while now.
Yeah.
Probably as long as Alden. Fair.
Tell us why Pride, Northampton Pride, Hampshire Pride is something that's still important to you, Alden.
Oh, I mean, that was just such a... I mean, working at Majestic for a while after COVID, we were really the only queer bar I could think of in the area. And there was a hole missing. It was a hard thing to put together, as we know now. And we really needed to keep that going. I mean, people talk about Northampton, they associate it with being this queer place that everyone should check out. And when there's only like one queer bar and like they don't even have the Pride Parade anymore, it's
right.
What's happening? So we definitely did everything we could do to get that back on track. And I'm really excited for the direction things are going this year and in years come.
What about you, Clay? Why is this something that's still important to you?
As you alluded to, me coming from Florida, it's a very different political climate there.
Is it?
And I didn't wear 7-inch stilettos, you know, walking into a radio station down there, put it that way. Knowing that the kids these days, and I know I'm dating myself, and just seeing that they get to experience this, I never went to a Pride parade. I thought it was a big city, like that's the only place you could go and see gay people was in the city. And so letting rural or suburban communities know that gay people exist, queer people exist all over, that's I think where the magic is.
Tell me that there is at least one Star Wars themed drag act happening.
Because it is May the 4th.
I will not spoil anything.
Okay.
Clay Pearson and Alden Peotter, who are two of the organizers of Hampshire Pride. The parade is this Saturday. It starts at 11 with festivities and rally and drag review and music and vendors behind thorns between 1 and 6. And don't forget about Elliot Page in a fireside chat with Dallas Dukar from Trans Health happening the next day in Northampton on Sunday at the Academy of Music. Thank you both so much.
Thank you for having us.
So much fun to come on the show.